Jesus came through right on time. Thank you, Jesus.
Still can't believe
all the ways.
Yes.
Father, welcome back. I look and I see Hope Corps students have returned from Roatan. Let's give them a big welcome home. I'm proud of them. I was able to be there for part of the meeting. Got in on Thursday evening, and let me just tell you, the Jones family is doing an incredible job. I was able to be a part of a brand new church plant in the city of French Harbor on the island of Roatan, and I'll just tell you what, it's incredible what God is doing there, and I want you to be continuing in prayer for the Jones family. And I wish you could have seen Abigail Babineau. She's playing the piano and leading worship, man. It's just incredible what God's done. And young people, we're glad you're back. And a great time. If you have your Bible, let's go to the book of Acts and the book of Ephesians. And while you're turning there, I'm delighted to have friends of mine for a long time. And Brother Dan and Sister Betsy, good to see y'all. Give them a hand today. Amen. What a tremendous worship leader, Betsy. Good to see you. Amen. And by way of announcements, coming up August 12th. Everybody say August 12th. It's All Nations Sunday, one of the highlights of the year for us. And this is kind of the first of the big announcements coming up. If you can help us, as you know, I think last year we had 21 or 22 different food booths of 21 or 22 different ethnic foods offered, and we celebrate what God is doing in our community here. Amen. There are people from every tribe and tongue here. That's the way it ought to be, right? Amen. And so we celebrate that time together, and this is a wonderful time to bring your friends and family in the community to be a part of All Nations Sunday, and it'll be a big concert in here on that afternoon, one service only, and then following the concert, we'll just have a big party out front. And all the tents and stuff will be set up, and bounce houses and snow cones and all the stuff we do. And it's a good time together. So that's coming up on August 12th. And then Camp West starts tomorrow. There's already a big group that's already down there preparing because people start arriving in Monterey to the fairgrounds tomorrow. It's going to be a great, great time. Ages 7 through 21 in Monterey. So there is a mandatory meeting for all of you parents and children that are going to camp tomorrow in the fireplace after our altar service. So please go there after we are done. Let's go to Ephesians. We'll start there. And verse number 11. And then we'll go to the book of Acts. And to all of our guests, I want to join with the staff and Bishop welcoming you today. We're thankful for you being here with us. Verse number 11. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Now pay close attention. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. I want you to notice here, there's some tossing to and fro. And he wants that stature in Christ to be achieved, that we all, it's for everybody, no big I's and little U's, it's for everybody, so that there is no more being tossed to and fro, and then there are evidently winds of doctrine that can come and carry people away, and then there is those that, by the sleight of men, or the cunning of men, cunning craftiness, they deceive, they lie in wait, they're waiting, they're pouncing, they're hiding to destroy. But he says, if we get that, if we achieve the stature of Christ, then we don't have to worry about that because we won't be affected by that. And our last verse of this passage, but speaking the truth in love may grow up. Everybody say, grow up. Grow up. Into him in all things, which is the head, believe in Christ. Now let's go backwards a little bit to the book of Acts, 1 verse, chapter 20 and verse 28. And this primarily is most often referred to pastors and preachers, but we're all part of the prophetic community, so I think it applies to all of us as well. Take heed, therefore, unto yourselves and to all the flock, over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. I can't say I wrestled. I know preachers say that. I can't really say I wrestled, but I did give thought to not doing this tonight, because as you know, Sunday night is more evangelistic, and maybe we'll get evangelistic in the process. But I did feel, while I was in Honduras this past week, to go here tonight. And if it's maybe a little bit more laid back than what I normally do on Sunday night, I do want the Holy Ghost, I believe that the Holy Ghost wants to speak this to us tonight. And so I want to give this title, From Process to Production. From Process to Production. Put your Bible down, look somebody right now, shake them by the hand, and say, it's time to move through the process so that we can be productive. Amen. Give the Lord one more hand clap of praise. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. We're delighted for all of you being here and all of those watching via the web. We welcome you, and I received updates from a couple of pastors in the Tulsa area telling me that my preliminary remarks have been too long because they have to get to bed and they don't want me to be too long-winded. So I'm not going to mention their name, but Brother Schweitzer, I'm sorry. Just kind of get through this. Amen. Greetings to all of you around the world that are with us. From process to production. If you've been around the Rock Church for any amount of time, hopefully by now you have learned what we call the nesting vision of this church, that being helping people become. Would you say that with me? And if you're just plugging in and you're wondering what everything we do is about, we do our best. I can't say we always get it right, but we try everything that we do to fit within that matrix that we are working to help people become. And so everything we do, our ministry, we don't do everything. Maybe there's other churches that do other things. But for us, if there's something that may be done other places, we don't do it. It's because that doesn't really fit maybe the nesting vision of this church. And so we try to simplify. And you look on my right and your left, helping people become. You see Manifest. You see Urban Reach. You see Agape. You see Unite. You see Rock Nation. And the list goes on. These are our five major initiatives. But all of this is about us, you and I together, becoming what Christ intends for us to be. And it begins, if you don't have the experience that happened in Acts chapter 2, let me tell you how you become. That's where you start. You start with repentance, baptism in Jesus' name, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. You can't become what Christ wants you to be unless there has been a new birth experience. Can you say amen? And so that's where it springs forth, and it's called spiritual formation. Everything, if we're on the path of becoming, it begins in the spirit, just like in the Genesis account. It all began with the hovering presence of God, brooding over those waters. And then after that brooding took place, the voice of God speaks, and it was a spiritual formation. All that came out of that was the result of spiritual formation. And so as believers, that's the way it starts. It starts in the spirit. You can't get there by joining the church. You can't get there by shaking my hand. I can't do anything for you. Just coming and being a member doesn't do anything, because there's a few knuckleheads maybe on the pew next to you. Being a car, being in a garage doesn't make you a car. Just coming to church isn't going to do it. But when you allow the brooding presence of God to begin to come say spirit. I feel like I'm at a Baptist church right now because some of you are nodding at me. I shouldn't have said I was going to teach because some of y'all just kind of set back. Am I in a Pentecostal church tonight? I just wanted to make sure. I preached in Baptist churches before. I wasn't expecting it tonight. So it starts with spiritual formation. But I want everybody that has a position or a title of leadership in this church, would you stand up? Keep standing. All right? Now, if you're a Sunday school teacher, you're a leader. So that means you've got a title, okay? If you're an usher, you should be standing. If you're a hostess, you should be standing. If you're in the choir, you should be standing. If you're in the front line, you're a musician. That means you're in a place of leadership, right? Okay? All right? How many parents, keep standing. How many parents are in this house? Stand up. You're a leader, right? If you're a parent. All right? How many got the Holy Ghost? Stand up. So tonight, you didn't come to Zig Ziglar's Leadership Conference. You came to Myles Young and the Holy Ghost Leadership Conference. I'm going to have a leadership meeting for a minute. Because I'm here with all these leaders today. All right? You may be seated. We are leaders in one dimension or another, as we just identified. But we are more than just leaders. We are to exhibit spiritual leadership. We often refer to the Rock Church being an Antioch church, indicating that it is a sending center. It is a missional center filled with gifted people. And in this room are people of all kinds of understanding, knowledge, and spiritual gifts. And this is a church that God has called to lead. And so that's for that reason that we spin and we are spent. These are the things that are part of the DNA of the Rock Church. And we have known and have taught and have discussed that we are blessed to be a blessing. Because we are called in this last day to be a church that leads people to Jesus Christ. If a church is not leading the lost to Christ, then we need to close our doors and do something else. So if you've got the baptism of the Holy Ghost, then you have been called to be a Christian spiritual leader. Every one of us are called to lead. Now, there's been a lot of study, and let me slow down just for a minute if that's all right. There's a lot of study on the subject of leadership. We could go 100 different rabbit trails tonight, but we're not going to do that. I want to focus in on something that I think is going to help us in our walk with God. There is what is known by experts, what is called leadership emergence theory. That sounds fancy, so say it. Leadership emergence theory. All right, I think they've got a formula. Put that formula up there. I can just leave it up there for the next little while. I'm going to try to explain this. This is what people that have studied Christian leadership for many, many years, they have done. One particular man that I read has done over 600 Christian leadership studies, not in Scripture, that was beyond Scripture, of key leaders through the last 100 years, over 600 of them. And then after those 600, he then went through the Scripture with a whole team of researchers. And this is the formula that these biblical and religious experts have coined and have put together as a formula for leadership emergence theory. Now, what is this? The L stands for leader. Everybody say leader. A leader functions, that's what the F is. A man or a woman that can function as a leader, it happens through what's within that parenthesis. And the P stands for process. Everybody say process. The T stands for time. Everybody say time. And R stands for response. Everybody say response. If you want to be a leader, you need to pay attention right here. If you want to be a great spiritual leader, if you've got a title, if you've got a position, if you're a father, if you're a mother, if you're a leader in this church and you want to have influence for the good, pay attention tonight. We may not run the aisles, we may not jump up and down unless the Holy Ghost does that, but I want you to learn something because this is going to help you. This is the formula that has been determined by experts in studying all of these characters of Scripture and studying six hundred key leaders of history over the last 100 years of faith. This is what they determined. The functioning leader is one that can move through process, time, and response. Let me break that down a little bit better in the introduction here. This is the unique development of a man or a woman that is able to experience over their life in time things that come in the process of their life. And as that time, those times of experiences or incidents would be a more appropriate term, how they then respond to those events and incidents in their life, how they respond to it determines their ability to function as a leader. That's what that stands for. Now, I want to begin to bring that into our now. Much of what is characterized or what characterizes a leader. You want to be a leader. So what characterizes a leader when you look at them can be explained by this formula. If you're taking notes, this would be a good time to take notes. In terms of the timing of significant processes in that man or woman's life and how that individual responds to that. This is a heavy thought. I know that this isn't milk tonight. We're going to chew some meat, so get your knife and fork out. There are going to be things that happen. Young people, pay attention to me. When you begin to live life, you're going to experience some things that are going to happen to you. And how you respond to them will determine what kind of person you become. And what is the unseen thing that maybe isn't on our mind because we're just thinking survival, get through it, get through the incident, get through the struggle, get through the fight. But what you need to understand that if you are a spiritual leader, you're a believer, you're filled with the Holy Ghost, then what happens in your life, God has either sent it or allowed it into your life. That means he is allowing that thing to work in you and on you and through you to do something with you. And that is in these times, that is what is called processing. Now the goal that God has for all of us, as we read in our text, is that we all achieve the stature of the fullness of Christ. Our text said till, everybody say till. Till we all come into the unity of faith, the knowledge of the Son of God, into a perfect man, or that means a complete man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. But don't overlook that little word till. That has to do with that T. Till means you're going to have to go through some stuff. That means time is involved in you becoming or achieving the stature of Christ. What that means is you don't get it all on one Sunday night. Well, Brother Young, I thought that this was all done through spiritual formation with a chirological explosion. You're right. But understand something. You're going to have to live a little while with what happened to you on Sunday night. You're going to have to stay on the shining path, as we heard this morning, because God's working on your life, and you're going to have to get through some things until... revelation tonight, because God wants to complete something in you. When you got the Holy Ghost, there were back and study all those feasts. Took all the leaven out. Remove all the leaven. But when it came to the feast of Pentecost, he said, leave a little leaven in there. Because what was the next feast that came right after that was the Feast of Trumpets, which was a time of the proclamation and declaration of the word of God. Set the trumpet to thy mouth, sound the alarm of my holy mountain. What he's telling you is at Pentecost, you got an experience, you got justified, but now you got to get sanctified. And you're going to need a trumpet in your life. So leave a little leaven at Pentecost so that the trumpet can speak. And this is the process that when you have that chirological interruption in your life, it's not over and done. That's the beginning of a moment where the sovereign hand of God interrupted your life. But now you're going to walk with him till you achieve that fullness, the stature of Christ. That's what spirit life is. It's that moving from justification through the process of sanctification. Everybody say the process. So let me explain how this works. This is the process of the development and shaping of a spiritual leader. God uses a process through time and how we respond to create us to be the man or the woman that God calls us and has designed us to be. Now, I want you to listen actively. I want you to participate in this, because if you get this, it's going to make you stronger. In my life, in your life, incidents are part of the process. Don't miss that. Incidents are going to happen in my life, in your life. In every leader, there are incidents. In fact, I'll go out on the edge and tell you, if there have not been critical incidents in your life, you'll never be a leader. There's a lot of debate. Are leaders born? Are leaders trained? Are leaders called? Are leaders, let me just tell you, it takes all of them. But not every person born with gifts achieves greatness. Because you can't overlook the R. What you do with the incident determines what kind of man or woman you become. The incidents of your life are critical. Everybody say critical.
Critical.
If you were to take one of these older men of God, if you were to take my father-in-law, and you would sit them in a room and turn on a video camera and begin to interview them and say, all right, Dr. Wilson, all right, Bishop Young, talk to us. Tell us about how you became a leader. Probably one of the very first things that would happen is they would talk about their conversion experience, an incident. Then they would point back to maybe a revival with a verbal bean, or a revival at Fields, Louisiana, or something. You've heard it 100 times as they preach. They can't even preach for very long without it coming out as they refer back to incidents in their life. Those are the things in your life, in my life, that develop me. Understand, you are a child of God. He either allowed it or sent it. And behold, all things work together for the call. Those that love the Lord, it's all working out for the good of them that are called and love the Lord. Understand something. Just because you're going through hell right now doesn't mean you're backslid. It don't mean you're lost. What it means is God either allowed it or God sent it, because he's working on your life for you to be the leader he's called. Actually correlate. You can take your life, and some of you are thinking of events in your life or incidents over the last 20 years of your life, and you probably could draw them out and correlate them into particular categories, and that's what it is. It's actual occurrences in your life. Now, just so you don't miss what I'm talking about, see it in two dimensions. Everybody say, the sovereign hand of God and the providential hand of God. Okay? So you have
what would be sovereign moments and providential moments. For our rock church rockers that have been around a long time, chirological moments, that's where it comes exploding into your life, and chronological things that happened over time. So you walk into the Pentecostal church and you would expect somebody just invite you to the drama or concert, or you showed up at church and some crazy nut ran the aisles and was talking in a funny language and you went up to the altar and boom, the Holy Ghost exploded on you. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You can point to that. But then there are other moments where over a lifetime you can look back and look how God has worked day after day after day. So some are chirological and some are chronological. The sovereign hand of God and the providential hand of God, where he's been moving and working in the prevenient grace of God, setting you up as systems. And so you get invited to go travel with another preacher, and you're doing youth ministry, and then you wind up in California at a campground, and you just happen to see a pretty girl walk by, and you take her out the next night, and then you get married a few months later, and then you wind up in California, then you wind up pastoring. See, that wasn't, yeah, that was chirological. I was in love the moment I saw her. Boom! Shakalaka. But then the providential hand of God began to, day after day. You see, I could have never had it without that interruption. But after the interruption, there was a day-to-day living out. So don't overlook it and say, well, I can only point to two or three big chirological moments. They're big. But understand something. That's not the only way God works. God also works in your everyday life over years, weeks, and months with people and incidents that maybe at the time you didn't really think much about. Here it was immediate. You knew. It was like a short time. Boom, I was changed. There was a high awareness that God was here. Man, this is a moment. But then if you've lived for God, you can look back and you can see how it was kind of an extended period of time where God was teaching me something. And I was growing in grace. And maybe I didn't always recognize that his presence was there, but he was working on me. And here, I'm highly aware this just happened. Or the presence of the Lord is here. I can feel it in the atmosphere. And then over here, I'm not feeling anything. It kind of doesn't even feel spiritual sometimes. Am I talking to anybody? Amen. And I'm not talking in tongues over there. I'm falling out, rolling the aisles, and I'm just, God's all over me. And here, it's kind of like, I'm not feeling a lot. I'm not real aware of it, but I'm moving through time. It's all part of process. And how? Yeah. Now is the day of salvation. I got to respond now because it's a chirological interruption. It's exploding and interrupting my skin. I know I was going to do that tomorrow, but right now I've got to get saved. You got to respond. But guess what? I also have to respond on Monday the right way. And on Wednesday the right way. And on Friday the right way. Because I'm not just going to be come by the chirological moment. I have to become by the day-to-day living out my faith. And how I respond to the process both sovereignly and providentially. This is the processing of a leader. Now, these incidents, I want to help you. Y'all okay? These incidents, whether sovereign or providential, either side of either of the dimensions, four things you got to understand why they come. They indicate, don't miss this, they indicate God sends these critical incidents into your life. He sends a chirological interruption. What are they going to do with that? Then he gives you 6 months through a process. What's she going to do with this? What's he going to do with this? The reason is because God uses these critical incidents to indicate your leadership capacity.
number one. Number two, if you pass the test, your potential is then expanded. And by passing it, it confirms the appointment to leadership. All of you people that feel called to ministry, I hope you're paying attention. And number four, once that potential begins to expand and it's evident, we say things like, the hand of God is upon him, the hand of God is upon her, there's really anointing upon her. What's happening is you've proven that there's a capacity for leadership. Then he begins to expand that capacity, and confirmation comes in order then to direct the leader to fulfill the divine purpose God has for their life. The only way to get there is to move through the incident. You're never going to have one explosion interruption of spiritual formation in the moment and then wake up in your destiny. It never happens that way. You're going to be exploded on. You're going to be interrupted. There's going to be a shaking. The voice of God's going to speak. But when you quit talking in tongues, you're going to have to walk it out. You're going to have to respond in time and learn to function through the process and time and respond correctly. So in one dimension or another, either sovereignly or providentially, every single one of us in this room tonight are in the process. I want to give you two now so you think I'm preaching and not teaching. I'm going to give you two biblical examples. The first one is found in a character we know well. Daniel chapter 1 verses 8 through 21 describes the processing of a key leader in the scripture. Daniel was a gifted man. He was part of the group that was captured, taken captive, and taken to Babylon by Nebuchadnezzar. He had gone through and he had ascribed to his leaders to find the princes and those that were the king's seed. He said, I don't want you to go get a bunch of leaders. I want you to go, losers, I want you to get leaders. I want you to go get the princes. I want all those that got king's blood in them. He's evidently got the DNA records. He's found out who's who. Get them in here because I'm going to use them in my kingdom. And so he brings this group into Babylon. And here Daniel and three other young men are put under the authority of Ashpenaz. And Ashpenaz begins to work with them. And here is, I want you to get the picture. This is critical incidents in the life of Daniel and his three friends. It has been a chronological interruption. They have been taken from their world. They have been taken captive and dropped into Babylon and put in Nebuchadnezzar's court. They are given the captain of the eunuch to rule over them. He begins to instruct them, and so you know the story. Here it is. He's appointed to his leaders. I want you to take these boys. I want you to fatten them up. These girls, fatten them up. I want them to look like us. I want them to be like us. He said, give them the king's meat. I want them to drink the finest of the wines because these are people with real potential. These are potential leaders here that I can influence. And let's do it this way. And so it begins. And the Bible said in verse number 8 that Daniel was determined not to defile himself with Babylon's whining and dining. Even though everything in his life has been disrupted, he's taken out of his family, he's taken out of that holy city, he is dropped in a heathen land, and now he is being forced into this world that he knows nothing of. Everything has been chirological, it's been interrupted. But here I want you to notice, this is a critical incident in Daniel's life. Young men, listen. Young ladies, listen. This is so revelatory. Even though he's in captivity, even though everything has been interrupted, even though everything is critical and it's dangerous and he's in a world far beyond his control, even in that moment, the leader in him begins to rise up. He goes, think about this. This young teenage boy goes to the king or the captain of the eunuchs, the leader over this whole group, and he goes to them and he says, hey, I need to work a deal with you. So here was an articulate young man. This is a man that had gone through Victor and had given thought to what he was going to say, how he was going to do it, how he could get through it. He probably did it with intense prayer because we know Daniel was a man of prayer. I know I'm going 90 miles an hour. I got a lot of ground to cover and you got to get this. But notice, he goes into this key leader who speaks directly to Nebuchadnezzar, the most powerful man
leadership emerge. And he says, the deal is, I can't define myself with the king's meat and the king's wine, because you know who I am, you know where I came from. So let's do this. Me and my three friends, we're going to do it this way. You give us vegetables, you give us water, you're going to take care of us, and we'll do our best. And in that moment, it was a critical incident. Here's a teenage boy away from home, away from his parents, away from that holy city, away from the temple, away from everything. He could have gone fat. It appears that everybody else had given in. He could have compromised his conviction. He could have just looked around and said, well, it's a new day. We're in a new world. Let's just give in here and let a little bit down here. And, you know, after all, God's evidently put us in this new. But no. In that moment, it was, yeah, there had been the interruption, but now there's a deal. There's a time period where he's going to have to live it out. There's no choir singing. There's no youth pastor to check on him. There's just 10 days. You're going to have to grind it out in front of everybody. And it was that 10-day test. That was a critical incident. And the Bible said, when he came to it, notice the pattern. God gave them, the four boys, knowledge, skill in all learning and wisdom to understand vision and dream. Don't overlook L equals F, which is PTR. What happened was he got to a critical incident in his life that was going to require time of process. Could he pass the test? But by living out his faith, when the critical incident happened, I'm preaching to you even though it sounds like I'm teaching, even in that critical moment when it would have been a lot easier to just let everything go and merge with everybody else, he stood, those four boys stood, and in the process said, all right, I'm going to expand their capacity. And in that moment, he imparted to them dreams and wisdom and philosophy and knowledge and science, what they have been before. Young people, don't miss this. What they had gone into the incident with, they came out. It was the process of leadership emerging through process, time, and proper response. Let's look at another leader. I'm almost done. This guy he's one of the born leaders. I mean, it just came in the world. You've seen it. On the playground, you can tell he's got it. As a teenager, he stood head and shoulders above everybody else. I mean, this guy had a prophetic touch. He prophesied. He was anointed. He was first. He was a first edition. I mean, there was nobody like Saul. He even now has the title. He's got the position. And then there comes a critical, a chronological moment of interruption. See, not all chirological moments feel like revival. Sometimes God sends interrupting things as testing. And so the word of God by Samuel comes to Saul. All right, Saul, you're the leader. You're the king. You've been anointed. Go to Amalek. You know what Amalek did to my people. And it's payday that has come. I want you to utterly defeat them. I want you to slay everything. I want you to kill everything. I want it utterly destroyed, because what they did to my people, I'm going to take care of it once and for all. The anointing is upon this leader. He goes out, and just as the anointing, which destroys the yoke, it's destruction mode, and victory comes to the Israelites under the anointed, gifted leadership of Saul. But what Saul did not recognize is there had been the interrupting moment, but now the battle had to be lived out. And in the process of the battle, his response wasn't quite And so what happened is he now began to lean on his own understanding, and he began to judge in himself what was good and what was bad. He chose what was right and wrong, and he got rid of what he thought was wrong and kept what he thought was right, which was contrary to what the prophet of God, speaking for God, had told him. So in the process, after the interruption, in the time of battle, his response was wrong. He decided to keep Agag alive because that's what heathen kings did, is make the former king your servant. What a great way to promote myself, and what great leadership I exhibit. The problem was, that wasn't what God intended. And in fact, it was not what God had said. So he kept Agag in the best of the flocks, the best of this, the best of that. He decided to do it his way. You have two different characters, both with interruptions and both with providential testing. One passes and is expanded. One responds incorrectly, and what he had was taken from him. It repented me, God said, that I had set up Saul to be king, because he turned back, and God literally said these words, he has not performed. What you and I do with the critical incidences of our lives determines what kind of leader we become. Saul did not pass the processing. He failed in the critical incident of his life. The critical incident, because he responded incorrectly, he failed to pass to processing. He never got to production. He got stopped in the process. How many great leaders were gifted and anointed that God could have mightily used, but they never made it out of process? Because they failed in the time of their life to continue to the end in obedience. And as a result, they never made it to production. I'm preaching to you tonight that there are critical incidents in your life if God is going to make you a leader. I want to bring this returning base now. There's base and then there's fire. We're going to turn base. Everyone else, don't miss this. Young, old, preacher, saint, usher, hostess, singer, musician. Every one of us that claim to be a Christian will have integrity tests. It's going to happen. God arranges processing incidents to test us, to evaluate our hearts and our intents, that will reveal if we have leadership capacity. Number one, there's the challenge. Number two is the response. And if passed, then there is expansion. Everybody say the challenge. Everybody say my response. If I pass, say, then I expand. Hear me. I hope you're listening tonight. Because if you pay attention, in your life, the sovereign interruptions are the providential outworking of time. There are going to be challenges that you and I have to respond to. And if we pass through the test, our leadership will expand. But it's going to be a process. I don't know which way it's going to happen next for you. For somebody this week, there may be a sovereign chirological interruption of which you're highly aware. It may be in the service. You know. know, God, I need a change tonight, and I feel you, and that may be it. And the proper response tonight is you fall on your face and you repent, you get your life right with God. That's the proper response. But then there may be somebody that God's got a providential set of lessons or tests for you to go through. The proper response is you get up and do the perfect will of God. The perfect will of God is the present duty at hand. You may not feel like talking in tongues. You may not feel like preaching to thousands. You may just be grinding life out, and it's all you can do to get back to church. It's all you can do to sing. It's all you can do to pray. It's all you can do to keep your sanity and not cuss somebody out, slap somebody in the face. But just keep going. Just tie your hands down if you have to. Zip your lip if you have to. Get up, walk out of the room. But don't fail the test. Because God is using those things to test your integrity. Sometimes it's easier when it's interrupting, but it's those daily ones that we often overlook. I'm going to give you these quickly. I'm not going to preach about them. I'm just going to give them quickly so you kind of understand what to look for. Everybody say nine kinds of integrity tests. You mean there's nine of them? Yeah. One of the ways you're tested, they're not going to be the same every time. Temptation. It's going to be temptation to come to your life. And that is the test of a leader. Do they have real conviction? Or do they just have a title? Do they say they have conviction? Well, there'll be an integrity test. Then there's the test, what is called restitution. That means, are you really honest? If nobody's looking, what are you going to do? Honestly, are you really honest? Then there is the value test. God knows how to interrupt your life or let some things unfold to find out what you really value. Or are you looking for a better offer? Then there is the loyalty test. It's going to check your allegiance. What are you loyal to? Then there is the guidance. Are you willing to be spirit-led, or are you going to figure out some other thing to work out the system? Abraham and Ishmael as a result. Then there will be the conflict against ministry vision. That means God's got a vision for your life, but it don't match what you had in store or planned for your life. There's going to be a test where what you want for your life and ministry may not be what God wants. It's an integrity test where you have to go to a garden, pour yourself out, and say, not my will, but thy will be done. Then there's the word conflict. Are you willing to obey? Number eight, there's the leadership. Are you willing to submit to the leadership of your life? Because even leaders have to follow. And then lastly, there will be persecution. You can live for God. It may come sovereignly with an interrupting moment of persecution, or it may be over a period of time. What are you going to do with it? Now, remember, process, time, and response. How you respond to that sovereign moment or how you respond to the providential moments determines the leader you become. These incidents, are you still with me? I'm almost done. These incidents indicate mine and yours, our capacity. If we cannot handle temptation, we just revealed our lessening or our lack of capacity. If we can't learn submission, we just revealed we're not qualified. If we just gave in because we were persecuted, he says, I mean, I like you, your head and shoulders, but you don't have the staying power for what it's going to take to be a leader. Because I've got a divine destiny that I got to get you to. But if you can't pass the integrity test, if you then pass through submission and obedience and value and conviction and restitution and honesty. If you can't maintain them when that thing interrupts your life on vacation or that thing interrupts you every day at work, if you can't make it, I'm sorry, I can't anoint you. In fact, I got to take back what I've got and I got to give that to somebody else that'll pass the test. See, this is the real, this isn't about let's go run the aisles and talk in tongues all night and we'll come up Superman for Christ. No. You want to be a leader? You're going to have to make it through some hurdles. It's not easy believism. It's not pie in the sky. It's not claim it, name it. It's not blab it, grab it. Every one of us, we got to make it through the process. For Daniel, he passed the process. Musicians, would you come? Daniel, as a teenager, away from family, friends, and nation, and temple, and priest, and all of the above, surrounded by other teenagers, figured out a way that he passed the integrity test. He valued the things of God more than the things of the world. He valued acceptance by God more than acceptance by his friend. He learned, he proved to himself and he proved to God, I have the capacity to stand for righteousness. Here's the reality. Think about how great Daniel became. Daniel, if Brother Mike, if he had not passed that test, he would have never made it in the lion's den. See, it wasn't even a real big deal yet. It's just peer pressure. It's just red wine next to his friends. It's just, well, what are they going to think about me? I'm not eating the king's meat. I mean, I'm over here eating celery and cucumber. What are you, weird? Well, man, you're missing this filet mignon. I mean, it feels like a big deal when you're a teenager, right? Because you don't have the same shoes everybody else has got. You didn't go do the same things they all did at the club last night. It's a little bit of peer pressure. But you see, Daniel, if you don't respond correctly to this chirological interrupt, if you don't respond right here, and then if you don't live it out for the next 10 days, if you can't handle peer pressure, you'll never make it with the lions. And boys, if you can't handle just sitting at the table at the classroom, you probably don't have the capacity to look a fiery furnace in the face and say, we're not careful to answer you. Throw us in there. Our God will deliver us, but hey, if he doesn't, well, we'll be Christmas critters for Christ. See, that didn't start right there. That's what we all want. We love that. We tell that to our kids in Sunday school. We hardly ever talk about that vegetable meal. Because we love that. We love that lion shut up. We love that fiery furnace. Ooh, we love that. That ain't where it starts. It starts back there at the integrity test. Where you prove, yeah, God, in this thing I'm in right now, you prove my integrity. It's going to reveal to you, it's going to reveal to me, it's going to reveal to the kingdom of God, that young man, that young lady, that husband, that wife, that preacher, I can trust them. I can anoint them. It reveals the capacity. God says, I'll confirm you now, and then I'll take you into a destiny, Daniel, because you stood for me in my kingdom. I'm going to let there be a changing of kings and world powers. And my servant Cyrus is going to show up, and guess who's still going to be? Nebuchadnezzar's gone. But not Daniel. I want you to think about that. He proved his integrity. He proved his capacity to lead so much that when the greatest world ruler is removed and Cyrus the Great shows up, guess who's still hanging in the throne? The lion couldn't get him.
stay in this throne and bring the king down, I'll still be right here. Because he passed the test. I know we're not running, we're not jumping. But if we get this, we'll run a lot faster, jump a lot higher. Because God wants success for everybody. Now, I know what happens. Service like this, we start thinking about everything we didn't do right. Me included. Let's just be real. Okay, I'm gonna come down here. I'm just your brother right now. I'm not the preacher. I got the mic, so I'm still preaching. But let's talk one-on-one. There ain't one perfect person in this room. Sitting on the pew by you is somebody that has made a horrible wreck in their life at some point. We don't always pass the integrity test. If you say you do, you're a liar. Okay? We've all failed and stubbed our toe, bruised our shins, hit our head. This isn't about condemnation. But I will tell you what it is. This is a chirological interruption that says, hey! See, we're under a new covenant. It's a covenant of grace. We're not under law. That means if we're here right now, you got a chance to start over. And say, all right, man, huh, I have blown the integrity test for the last 25 years or 30 years or 40 years, but does this mean you give me one more chance? He said, yeah. So what I feel the Holy Ghost was doing. I just tell you what I really believe. I don't believe this is an average church. You're not average people. God has blessed this church. There's worldwide ministry, missions. We're a sending center. We've got people all over the world at this church doing mission work, and funding missions, and doing things. You know all that. This is a church of leaders. I preached to you the other day that Moses led with a rod or a staff. They got into Canaan's land, and God told Joshua, "Well, no shepherd's staff. Just take that spear. You lift the spear. When Moses lifted up the shepherd's rod, you're going to lift up the warrior's spear." This is a warrior church. We've come out of sin. We don't spend all our time talking about what we came out of. Thank God we're not what we used to be. But understand something, we didn't just come to sit on these pews. We came to conquer this city for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Yeah, I know there's the dimension where sheep will forever follow. I understand that. But understand this, we're warriors. And God is calling us to pass the test of our life. Integrity, godliness, holiness, wisdom, and righteousness. With these choices, either the moment that it erupts or the everyday grind to live it out. I want the musicians and singers to get ready to sing. I want us to stand. I really felt while I was in Honduras to come back. This will be my first message to you after returning. I'm looking while I'm in Honduras at a developing apostolic church. I'm watching Stephen and Rachel, young people. I think Stephen, what? Chris, Terry, where y'all at? How old is Stephen now? Is he 30? 30. Okay, Stephen and Rachel, 30 years old. Two little crumb crunchers running around the house. Man, those kids, they gone native. Man, they're running around barefooted on sand. Dirty roads. I mean, they're the cutest things. They're eating everything. They're picking bugs up the floor and eating them. I mean, they're just crazy. See, but Stephen and Rachel, they didn't go to be the missionary. They went to go help their father-in-law. He had a heart attack. So now you've got an unfinished building. The missionary's got a heart attack. You're 24 years old. You don't speak the language. You're on an island that you never knew existed until your pastor said you need to go help the missionary. That's a pretty chirological intervention. And then your father-in-law's lifelighted out to the mainland in San Pedro Sula. You don't know if he's going to live or die. Then they leave, and it's you and your little wife. And I remember the night he called me. I was preaching in North Carolina. The air code came up, and he's crying on the other end. He said, "Brother, you're not going to know what, you're not going to believe what happened to me today." He described the place where he was at. He pulled up. A man he didn't even know accosted him, began to accuse him of everything under the sun, lying in front of all the people. And people, a crowd gathered around. Here's this 24-year-old kid, don't even know the man from Adam, and he's lying about the church and lying about the training center, just lie after lie after lie. He was like, "Who in the?" Comes back, and the demonic forces, weeping, crying, "Pastor, what do I do?" We began to pray. By the time that prayer was over, he said, "I'm going to get through this." And I walked last week through what will be the most beautiful church on that entire island. I watched as 120 people, not Hope Corps, there was about 40 Hope Corps there on top of that. I watched as walking into that unfinished church on the beach there of the Caribbean Ocean, as 120 people walked in that building on Sunday, and I preached and people received the Holy Ghost. And then on Thursday night, I walked into an air-conditioned building with about 150 people crammed in there and people talking in tongues and saying in French Harbor. And I'm going, "My God, who would have thought that little short punk that would quit because he couldn't make a layup and got mad in the youth group? That kid?" You see what God had done? God had taken that little short guy. Sorry, Stephen, I'm having fun. This is preacher license. Took him, got him saved out of a broken home. God saved his family, put him in the church. He grows up in the youth group, and some of you remember Stephen running around here. And then he winds up, God exalts him, he winds up working for Arnold Schwarzenegger at the Capitol. And he said, "Man, God's on, this boy's got a track, man, God's doing stuff." And then he steps away from politics as a young 23-year-old man who's writing, some of y'all didn't know you were reading Arnold's press releases. Arnold didn't write them, Stephen did it. I'm telling you the truth. Well, that ought to give you hope in your politics, huh? And then God takes him to a little island. And now, because somewhere, he didn't get it perfect all the time, but somewhere he passed an integrity test and expanded. Sitting to put accolades on Stephen. That's just one you could relate to. It's Fred. And I'm sitting there and I'm looking at these faces of couples whose lives have been put back together. I'm looking at former gang members that are in the church. I'm looking at lives that were so messed up, that were drug addicts. One of the guys, you wouldn't even want to be in the same room. He was such a scary figure. And now, I watched him leaping in that service in Honduras, talking in tongues, and just waving their hands. And I'm thinking, God took that boy, put him here, and the Holy Ghost said, "You go back and you talk to the Rock Church about if they learn to make it through the process, I can use them for production." God's got a destiny for every man or woman in this room. You are a godly leader. The moment you got the Holy Ghost, you became a part of the prophetic community of Christ. You have been called to preach the gospel. Some of us behind pulpits and others over coffee tables and desks and over hammer swing. We are called the prophetic community. To the capacity that God blesses us, if we can respond correctly to that dimension, God wants to use us. They begin to sing, "If you want to make a good process to production, I want you to come."